Good now. I hope you're doing well. I don't know why I'm wasting my time and energy on this subject, knowing that nothing's going to change. And I don't mean that in a pretentious way, that the people in charge of revising and updating the English alphabet and language are all of a sudden, or should, stop and drop what they're doing and, listen to what I have to say. But I'm speaking, frankly, matter-of-factly, that nothing is going to change with the English alphabet or English language, like I believe it should, and others probably also think as well. And real quick, I don't know why, but I believe part of the reason why is that we are scared of change. I'm not saying that's the, main reason why the English alphabet, the flawed English alphabet hasn't been updated or anything in hundreds of years. But when it comes to change, we are sometimes as a society as a whole, a little hesitant, maybe even scared to do so. I mean, it just, when it comes to progress and progression and being progressive, it's a struggle sometimes, as we see in regards to certain things in society, even with our own lives. It's everything remaining the same. There's comfort in that, because it's the same. Nothing's changing, nothing to be worried about. But when you have to change where you, something like your attitude, your belief, you bring things into question, you have to change where you live, change jobs, it's nerve-wracking. Now, I know, I'm sure, and I know I'm not the first to attempt to tackle this topic, and I won't be the last. I did mention this briefly when I was doing the podcast. I think I briefly touched on this subject in, was it 2021, I think. Anyway, there was a comedian who passed away in 2023 named Gallagher, who used to smash the watermelons as part of his skit on stage. And he went over the absurdity of the English language and the words and the alphabet, etc. So, and his, in that little skit of his, was definitely an inspiration to me when it comes to this topic and subject. And now, I'm not a teacher, and I never went to college, and you might hear me or have heard me say that quite frequently here and there over the course of different videos on my channel. But when it comes to certain things, you don't really need to be a teacher or an expert on this subject, especially with the English alphabet. And the reason that is, and the reason for that, that you don't need to be an expert, is because when you use something long enough, you eventually become aware of its flaws, and you become aware of ways that it can be improved. And so, as such, it is with the English alphabet, English language, grammar in general. English alphabet is a tool, but it's a flawed tool that needs, to seriously be looked at and updated and revised, just like you would with anything, any tools throughout history, that we've improved upon. Now, I'm not, and I have a little bit of an introduction thing here before we get into all of the letters of the alphabet and all that, which is the main part of this video. And we're going to get into that in, you know, about 5 or 10 minutes from now. Now, I'm not seeking or expecting perfection, but what I do expect is progression. There is no such thing as perfection, which is kind of good in a way, because that means there's always room for improvement, and that's no different with the English alphabet. Just like our minds and bodies, you know, as we grow physically, intellectually, or we grow in our attitudes about ourselves or towards one another, you know, towards society, you know, that same kind of growth, that attitude, that, you know, progression should be applied here to the English alphabet and to, you know, many other things in society, government, etc. Using logic, being consistent and efficient, sometimes keeping it simple, stupid, K-I-S-S is the acronym for that, simplicity, should be how we approach certain things, especially when it comes to the English alphabet, where there is a lot of inconsistency and a lack of logic, or many illogical aspects. Okay, so we're going to pretty much start to get into everything. But before we do, I want to share with you somewhat of an analogy of what the English language, what the English alphabet is, being shapes and symbols that represent sounds. All right, so do you see this shape has 4 equal sides, and we call that a square. It is always a square. It never changes. This next shape is called a circle because it is a perfectly round shape, has no beginning or end, no sides. And then this last shape we call a triangle because it has 3 perfect, 3 equal sides, 3 equal angles of the, you know, where each of the sides meet, and we call that a triangle. Now, when we put these 3 shapes together, do they become something else? No, it's still square, circle, triangle. Square is always a square. Circle is always a circle, and triangle is always a triangle. At no point ever does a square become a circle, does a circle become a triangle, or does a triangle become a square, okay? Now, obviously, we can get into the fact where certain triangles have longer sides, and then we have isosceles triangle and things like that, or the square becomes 3D, becomes a cube. All right, but that's the technical, you know, aspect of things. But we're talking about simple shapes, you know, and what they are. And square is always a square, circle always a circle, and triangle always a triangle. All right. And even when you put them all together, if you put 2 squares side by side, 3 triangles and 2 circles, it's always 2 squares, 3 triangles, and 2 circles, or whatever I just said. No, those, the triangle, circle, and square, when put together, they don't all of a sudden represent a different type of shape or anything, or a new meaning. So it's this same logic and principle that I believe should be applied to the English alphabet. So we'll get into a little bit of that more in just a moment. Do you know that apparently the last time the English alphabet was updated or revised was about 400 years ago or 500 years ago in the 16th or 17th century? In the 1500s or, in the 1600s, something like that. That was when the letter J was added to the alphabet. Now, I'm pretty sure that's the last time the English alphabet was updated or revised. Now, I read somewhere that the ampersand, the and symbol, was in the alphabet at one point, but removed. But even still, the letters A through Z, forget about the ampersand, have not been touched for apparently like 400 or 500 years. Is that insane? Like, do you know of any tool? Do you know of anything? You know, well, we have the spoon, right? So that's a tool that doesn't really need to be updated or revised. But the foundation of our very language, it is not just flawed, it has a lot of inconsistencies and illogical aspects about it, but it hasn't been updated or revised for, what's 1,000 years? I don't know, is 1,000 years a millennia, right? So half a millennia is the last time the English alphabet has been updated. Now, there is another thing when it comes to the English alphabet, and that is the phonetic alphabet, or the phonetic dictionary, however that's called. So, when you look at a word and you're unsure of how to pronounce it, which doesn't make any sense, because when you look at a word, you should know how to pronounce it. But the alphabet and all the different words have become so absurd that there are many cases where you are unsure. So you have to how do I pronounce this? So you have to refer to the phonetics, or to the phonetic alphabet, which doesn't make sense. So in my opinion, and I'm sure I'm not alone on this, perhaps the English alphabet should also consist of phonetic alphabet. Because there are some letters in the English alphabet that have multiple sounds. Again, that's like saying a square can also be a circle and a triangle, like I have in the thumbnail, like the letter C. And we'll get into that, or the letter A. Okay, some of the other things that don't make much logical sense about the English alphabet are the letter combinations. Again, the English alphabet is symbols and shapes to represent sounds. So remember square, circle, triangle? When you put them together, it's still square, circle, triangle. You know, all of a sudden they don't take on a new, you know, type of shape or sound. Well, when you put the letters E and I together, as in either or either, depending on how you pronounce it, or they make the A sound, as in way, W-E-I-G-H, way. Of course, there's the word W-A-Y, which is also way. Now, before we go any further, I know that a lot of these, the English language was created, I think, in Europe, long before the United States was settled and created and all that. So I know a lot of these words, have European or even Latin, etc., origins, okay? So maybe at the time, 400, 500 years ago, when these letters or these words and these combos were created, and that was acceptable at that time. But this is now the 21st century, 2023. It's time to really take a look at how we use these letters and their combinations and the sounds they make, and, you know, maybe once and for all do something about it. Other letter combos that make new sounds is the letter U and E together make the oo sound, as in glue, G-L-U-E, glue. The A-U combo makes the a or ah sound, as in laughter, L-A-U-G-H-T-E-R, or the aw sound, as in daughter, D-A-U-G-H-T-E-R. And then you have the combo G-H, which makes the F sound in laughter. So, again, more inconsistencies and just illogical nature. Why would we want to put G-H together to make the F sound when we already have the letter F doing that? Again, laughter is an old, probably, you know, it's a European, German word or something like that, you know, that kind of origin. And I understand that, but maybe it's time to change that and spell it L-A-F-T-R, laughter. There's no need to have an E in there. There's no need for the A-U, and there's no need for the G-H. It's too many letters. And then we have the word tear and tear, spelled exactly the same, T-E-A-R. One means to rip, and the other means to cry. And then we have T-A-R-E, which is the weight of a container, the tear weight of a truck's, you know, the container that a truck is hauling. So again, we have one word, T-E-A-R, that has multiple meanings and different sounds. And that just doesn't make sense. We should look at these words. We should look at these symbols, these shapes, and know that they sound, they make one sound. And when you put them together, you know, that's the, you know, the sound they make. We shouldn't look at a word, T-E-A-R, like square, circle, triangle. You know, right? Always square, circle, triangle, not square, square, circle, or anything. So we should look at T-E-A-R and know that it's only pronounced one way. And if you want to have a word that means to rip or, you know, to cry, then they should be spelled differently. We also have redundant letters and sounds, like the word hay, H-A-Y, you know, what horses eat. Why is there a Y at the end when the letter A makes the A sound? So H-A should be pronounced hey. Why have the Y at the end, especially when Y makes the Y sound? You're not saying hey Y. So there's a lot of more inconsistencies and, you know, logical fallacies with these symbols that have multiple sounds to them. It doesn't make sense anymore. We also have redundant letters, like words that have the same letter duplicated, such as the word ball has two L's. Why two L's? We don't need two L's. One L makes the L sound, so ball should be B-A-L. Grass, there's only one S needed. One S makes the S sound, so G-R-A-S, grass. Buzz, again, Z, you know, only one Z is needed, B-U-Z, buzz. And then we have silent letters. Why? You know, why? There's no, it doesn't make any sense. Knight, the medieval armor-wearing knight, K-N-I-G-H-T. Why is there a K there? We're not saying K. We're not saying knight. Why is there a G-H in there, too? Really, it should be N-I-T, night. But, you know, you would look at NIT now, today, you would say knit, right? But I, again, that's another symbol that has multiple sounds. Again, which doesn't make sense, isn't very logical or rational. And again, we have silent letters in the word pterodactyl. We're not saying the P in the beginning. There's no need for that. We have the word two, T-W-O, which represents the number two. Why is there a W in there? We're not saying T-W-O. We're not saying two. We're saying two. We're skipping the W altogether. Again, that doesn't make any sense anymore. Maybe it made sense 400 years ago, but again, that was 400 years ago, or 500. All right, and just before, last couple things before we get into going over each of the letters of the alphabet, we have words with multiple meanings. Once again, kind of what I alluded to, we have, or what I already briefly mentioned, with the word tear, meaning to rip, or tear, spelled the same, meaning to cry, we have words with multiple meanings. Why? That's like saying, that's like saying a square can sometimes be a circle and can sometimes be a triangle. No, never. It can never. That symbol, those four lines put together perpendicular to each other that are equal size, are always a square. A square is never anything else besides a square. All right, we're not talking about one side being longer than the others. We're talking about four equal sides, always a square, just like a circle. Perfectly round oval is a circle. All right, when you maybe stretch it out in a certain direction, it becomes an oval, but a perfectly round shape is a circle and always a circle. A circle is never a square, ever. Okay. So that same kind of logic, when you look at a shape, especially in regards to the English language, the English alphabet, when you look at a certain letter, it should make a certain sound, and one sound only. And when it comes to words with multiple meanings, that shouldn't be a thing. It really shouldn't. Just like the word R-E-A-D, read, and then it also makes the sound red. To read a book and then to have read a book. How is that logical? And then you have the word R-E-D, which is red, the color. So we have R-E-A-D, red, and R-E-D, red. Does that make sense? No, it doesn't. All right. Lastly, there may be other things about this topic that I have missed. I'm not trying to make a complete, ultimate guide, some kind of thesis, and this is the way that we should fix it. This is supposed to be just a laid-back, casual conversation on just my own opinion and view and perspective on how I think, not necessarily the changes we should make, but just pointing out the flaws. That's pretty much what I'm good at. I may not always have the ideas on how to improve things. Sometimes I do. I don't have any specific ideas aside from maybe introducing, you know, combining the English alphabet with the phonetics, you know, making one new alphabet of those, you know, that combination. You know, the only other ideas I have are new. If we're not going to do that, then introduce new shapes and symbols to represent some of the sounds that multiple letters make, and things like that. But, you know, like I said, this is more of just my frustration, my calm frustration with the English alphabet and the language in general, and just pointing out the flaws and, you know, trying to add something to the conversation and just most likely wasting my time because nothing's going to change. Okay, I'm going to go over, for the rest of the video, I'm going to go over each and every letter and kind of talk about the sounds they make and you know, things like that. So let's start off with the letter A. This has at least 5 different sounds that I know of, that I thought about. Maybe it is just 5. It makes the A sound, as in gray. It makes the A sound, as in hat. It makes the A sound, as in ball. It makes the A sound, as in what. And it makes the A sound, as in watts, electricity, watts, or water. So those are all, if you ask me, those are all, you know, those are 1, 2, 3, those are 5 different sounds made by one symbol, one shape. That's like saying a square, sometimes a circle, sometimes a triangle, sometimes a line, sometimes a dot. Well, that's not how it should be. The letter A should make one sound only, and when it comes to ah, aw, ah, and those are 4 different sounds. I mean, just listen to that. A, ah, ah, and aw. Okay? Those are 5 different sounds represented by one symbol, one shape. Those should be 5 different letters. And then, so I can just imagine what it must be, the frustration, what it must be for a teacher to say, this is the letter A. Right, we're teaching that symbol, that shape, to be pronounced as A, but then here's the word H-A-T, hat. It's not hate. It's not, so we're teaching that this symbol and shape is pronounced A, but when we put it in certain, with other letter combinations, it becomes ball, all. Well, wait a minute. You said that's the letter A, so it should be bail, B-A-L-L, bail. Oh no, that's ball. So you see, so that's the logical fallacy and the inconsistency. All right, moving on, we have the letter B. Well, we teach that the letter B is pronounced B when it should just be B. It's the letter B, as in ball, as in break. We're not saying B-rake, we're saying break, B. We're not saying be-all, ball. We're not saying that's be-all. We're saying that's ball, B. So that's the letter B. It's not the letter B. You're adding B plus E. That's a word. That's not a, you know, that's 2 sounds. B, E, B. So we should be teaching the letter B is B, in my opinion. Next, we have the letter C, which probably shouldn't exist or should have its own sound. My idea is perhaps it should represent the sound ch. That is one sound, ch. But in order to represent that sound in the English alphabet or in a word, you have to put C together with H. And that doesn't make any sense. Ch, ch, that's its own sound, should have its own symbol. But no, the letter C sounds like the letter K, k, and S, s, depending upon how it's used. So we have the word circle. And right there is a perfect example of the absurdity of the English alphabet. Circle, C-I-R-C-L-E. The same letter, but 2 different sounds. How does that make sense? If I'm looking at C-I-R-C-L-E, it should be pronounced Kirkle or Circle. Or if the letter C is to take up a new sound and represent the sound ch, then seeing C-I-R-C-L-E, I would say Churchill. If we want to say circle, it should be S-I-R-K-L-E, not even E at the end. Why? Again, what is the point of the E at the end? Okay, maybe 500 years ago, or whenever the word circle was invented, we put an E at the end. Well, now it's time to change. There's no need to have an E at the end. So circle should be spelled just like it sounds, S-I-R-K-L-E. Maybe we don't even need the I in there, because R makes the R sound. So S-R-K-L, circle. All right, so the letter C needs to go. I think a lot of people agree on that. The letter C is just, it doesn't know what it wants to be, the S sound or the K sound. Or we get rid of K and let C be the K sound. I don't know, but it has to change. And then we have the letter D, which should be taught to be pronounced D, not D. Again, E is its own sound. D is its own sound. D, D. You're saying two sounds together. D should just be, the letter D should just be D, as in D-og, dog, D. You're not saying D-og, you're saying dog. Why are you saying the symbol and the shape for D is being pronounced D instead of just D? Right, so that doesn't make sense. It's the letter D. That's it. That's the sound it makes. D, 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 D. Different from T with the T. You know, the tongue changes where the tongue hits the roof of the mouth, or the way the tongue is used to pronounce D. A little different than T, 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 D, D, T. T is more of the tip of the tongue near the front of the roof of the mouth. D is kind of almost putting, you know, more of the tongue against the roof of the mouth. But yeah, it should be D, not D. And then we have the letter E, which has multiple sounds. It takes on the A sound, which doesn't make sense, as in the word way, W-H-E-Y, way, or as in hey, H-E-Y. Why? Why does E take on the A sound? That doesn't make any sense. That's illogical. It's not rational. So if we want to say hey, it should just be H-A, because A makes the A sound, in my opinion. We also have the sound of E, as in weed, W-E-E-D. But again, why are there two E's? That's not necessary. If the symbol and shape E make the E sound, then W-E-D should be weed. But E also makes the E sound, as in wed, W-E-D, wed, or red, R-E-D. And then you have the word even, like the word circle, where S makes two different sounds. Well, E makes two different sounds in the same word. It's not even, E-V-E-N. It's not Evan, it's even. How does that make sense? You have one symbol, shape, making two different, having two different meanings. And that's like the word even is like putting a circle, triangle, circle, square, but having the circle mean, you know, also a square. You see what I'm getting at? It doesn't make any sense. Again, it's just not logical or consistent to have this symbol, shape, E, have different sounds. Moving on to the letter F. And this is something that doesn't make sense. Why, with some of these letters, do we say the E sound in front of them? Letter F, letter M, letter N. It's just F. That's how we should approach teaching the letter F, not F. That's two different sounds. That's a word, F. That's E and F. Same with L. There's no need to say E in front of the L to teach what that symbol, that shape is. It's O. That's the letter O. That's the sound you're making. Ball. Life. O. You're not saying Baal, you're not saying life as in L-life. No, you're saying life. So, letter F, you know, we don't need to say the eh sound. We should drop saying that sound, because that is supposed to be, that's a sound represented by the letter F. I'm sorry, the letter E. So if you were to put EF together, then you would have F. But F on its own should just be F. That's a letter F. And that's how we should approach that whenever we see it. It's just F. It's the letter F, not F. Aside from that, I don't think the letter F has any multiple sounds. You know, I mean, besides saying F and not F. But if you know, there are other letter combinations that make the letter F sound, such as GH, and that doesn't make sense. You know, in the word laugh, L-A-U-G-H, well, you should just put F in there. So, again, like I said in the beginning, you know, some of these words have, you know, origins from Europe or Latin, you know, who knows. And that may have been fine 500 years ago, but it's time to change. It's time to, you know, progress. All right, then we have the letter G, which you're using the J sound to pronounce that, to teach how to pronounce that symbol. It should just be G. That's the letter G. It's not the letter G. G, that's J plus E. That's two sounds. That should be a word. G. And it is G-E-E, but it should be J-E. That's G. The symbol and shape G should be pronounced G, as in good, G-ud, as in great, great, as in German, G-E-R-M-A-N, German. Oh, no, wait, that's German. Right, I forgot. Gerbil. Not J-E-R-B-I-L. Gerbil is G-E-R-B-I-L. So another letter that has multiple sounds. The letter G is sometimes like the letter C or E. Sometimes it's the G sound. Sometimes it's the J sound that J makes. It doesn't make sense. Next, we have the letter H. Just listen to that. A. That's two different sounds. That's a word. Like and. Well, actually, and is like three sounds. The word bee. The bug, you know, that has wings. Bee flies around, gathers nectar, makes honey. Bee, that's two sounds. That's a word. H should be a word. Shouldn't be a letter. That's two sounds, but we have this letter H, which is actually the sound H. Why are we making the H sound? When we say hello, we're not saying H-hello. We're saying H-lo, hello. When we're saying hi, how are you? We're not saying H-I, H-ow, are you? Why would we say that's the letter H, but then you say it as in, you know, so we should be teaching the letter H is the letter, not H. That's two different sounds, and like I said, A makes that long A sound, but A makes five different sounds, so, you know, A should be broken into five different letters or something like that, or, you know, like I said earlier in the video, you know, combine the English alphabet with the phonetic alphabet. And then we have the ch sound, which should probably be represented by its own letter. All right, next we have the letter I, which also makes multiple sounds. Well, two, I think, at least. I didn't, you know, like I said, this is not meant to be the be-all, end-all of how to fix the English alphabet. I didn't, you know, I tried to put enough thought into it, but this isn't, like I said, supposed to be a thesis. I'm not going in front of the board of the English alphabet, you know, whoever's in charge of that, or, you know, I don't know, whoever's in charge of that. It doesn't make any sense. You know, we should all be in charge of the things that we use. So I, you know, if I'm using the English language and the English alphabet, I should have input and say on how to make it better. Not just a small group of people, but anyway, that's a topic for another day. So the letter I makes the I sound as in hide, ride, high, etc. But it also makes the I sound as in hit, sit, and all that. So again, we should have two different letters, symbols, and shapes to represent those sounds. That's like saying sometimes a square is a circle. No, square is always a square. So the letter I should just be I as in hide, or I as in hit and sit. Shouldn't have two sounds. So we need another symbol to represent I or I. Next we have the letter J. And I'm fine with the J sound. And again, that's how it should be taught to be pronounced. Not J. That's two sounds. That's J plus A. So that's like a word. And it is. Blue Jay, the bird. J-A-Y. But why is there a Y at the end? That's not necessary. That's redundant to have a Y when A makes the A sound. If you need to put a Y in there because you want to represent that the A takes on that A sound, well, if we had separate letters for the different sounds that A makes, and you want the original A shape and symbol to have the A sound, then all you need is J and A to make the J sound. You wouldn't need the Y. But when it comes to the letter J, we have jump, j-ump, you know, plenty of other words as well, but I don't think the letter J takes on a different sound. I didn't go through every, I couldn't think of too many other letters or words that have the letter J in them. But for the most part, I think J is fine as long as we teach it as J. That's the letter J. It's not the letter J. Okay, that's two sounds. It's the letter J. Okay, moving on to K. Again, why are we saying K? Why do we keep doing this? Why are we adding these extra sounds to the to these consonants? It's the letter K. Okay, hey kids, what is this letter? It's the letter K. It's not the letter K. We're not saying K. When we say the word kick, K-I-C-K, why do we have a C in there anyway? We're not saying that's the word K-K, K-K. No, that's the word kick. K-K-K-I-K. It really should just be K-I-K. Yeah, so when we say okay, we say O-K-A-Y. Again, there's no need for the A-Y in there. Well, actually, if we want to say okay, letters O, letter K, letter A. No need for a Y. If we didn't have the A-Y at the end, it would be oak. O-K, oak. So K should be taught to be pronounced K, because that's the sound that it makes. Moving on, we have L. Again, why are we saying eh in front of the O sound? It's the letter O. Hey kids, what's this letter? It's the letter O. It's not the letter L. That might as well be a word. E-L, L, as in elevator. E-L, A-V-A-T-O-R, elevator. E in front of the L is L. L by itself is O. And that's how it should be taught, in my opinion. And then we don't need two L's when it comes to ball or wall. Just need one L. One L makes that O sound, and one L is enough for wall and ball. Moving on, we have M. Again, E in front of the M sound. So, I mean, the word, the letter M is fine. Money, you know, microphone, Monday, whatever. M. But that's how we should pronounce, teach how to pronounce that shape and that symbol. M. That's the, hey, kids, what's this shape? It's the letter M or M. Whatever, but probably M. It's not the letter M, okay? We need to get rid of a lot of these extra letters and sounds we're making. Again, the letter N shouldn't be taught E, should just be taught N. That's the letter N. It's a little different, it's close to M, but you can hear the difference, N, M. Now I can say why we I can understand putting the E in front, M, N, but if we want to, you know, the letter N is actually N, N, perhaps N, and the letter M is M, M, N, and that's the problem with these two letters, is how closely they sound, because whenever you talk to someone on the phone, or you have to give someone your name, and you have M or N in your name, you always have to spell it. You know, M is in mom. You know, N is in night or no. Next, we have the letter O. And this is another case of a letter having multiple sounds. O, U, and A. So we have the O, the circle. It's more of an oval. Well, lowercase O is a circle. But it makes the O sound as in go, g-o. So this letter should probably make the O sound. I kind of like that because that's the shape that the mouth takes on. But then we have the O sound when you put two of them together to make the word food. Now two O's together make the O sound, but that's not logical. You really need a separate symbol and shape for the O sound. And then you have O making the sound, as in one, W-O-N, or the word one, the number, O-N-E. So we have, it makes the sound. So O makes the O, U, and And if you ask me, those should be three different symbols for three different sounds. So that when you look at the word W-O-N, it's not won. Now, if we're making O the O sound, the letter O, then looking at W-O-N should be won, but it's not. It's won. It's making the U sound. So put a U in there. That's won. I won a trophy, W-U-N. If you want to put an O in there, and O makes the O sound, then I won the trophy. All right, moving on to the letter P, for the most part. The letter P is just fine. But again, we're teaching it P. We're adding an E sound. That's not necessary. That's not needed, in my opinion. It should be the P. That's the letter P. That's how we should teach it, as in P, party. We're not saying P-arty. We're saying party. We're not saying hockey puck. We're not saying piuk, we're saying puck, puh. So, pod, peas in a pod. We're not saying peas in a pod, you know. So, moving on to the letter Q. I don't know. This is a strange letter. It's the O with a line through it. Do we really need the letter Q? That's, listen to that, k, u. That's almost like three sounds, k, y, and u. We have the y of y, we have the k of k, the y of y, and the u, which is a of the o sound, but should be a separate letter. So that's almost a word, q, and it is, c, u, e, q. So how is it that one symbol the letter Q can make the Q sound, but then these three symbols, C, U, E, make the Q sound. How is that logical? It's not. That's like saying a square is a square, but when you put square, triangle, circle together, you get hexagon. No, you don't. Square, triangle, circle is always square, triangle, circle. Whenever you see them, however you position them, doesn't matter, vertical, horizontal, diagonally, when you see those three symbols, square, circle, triangle, they are square, circle, triangle. So when we look at the letter Q, it needs to either not exist, or if it's going to represent a sound, it shouldn't be Q, U, U. That's three different sounds. And then when we look at the word Q, C-U-E, or Q-U-E-U-E, to be cued in a line, but the Q of a in a billiards, in pool, the pool Q, I think that's what it's called. It's been a while since I've played pool. But yeah, Q, C-U-E, or Q-U-E-U-E, whatever. It doesn't make any sense. Why three different symbols, C-U-E, make the Q sound? If I'm looking at C-U-E and C is, that's just, it doesn't make any sense, that word, C-U-E, the more I look at it. There should be no E. And the U, you know, makes, we'll get into U in a moment. Okay, anyway, I think you get my point there. Moving on to the letter R. No problem here for the most part, except it shouldn't be pronounced R. R. That's two letters coming together. That's two sounds coming together, as in the word A-R-E, R. So the letter R should be taught to be pronounced R, because that's the sound that it makes. Car, ride, etc. When you put the A in front, then it becomes R. But on its own, it's R. That's the letter R. I know this all sounds funny and strange because we're taught differently. We're taught to pronounce the symbol and shape that is R as R. So if you were all of a sudden going to school tomorrow and say, okay, or tell the entire world, we're now going to start pronouncing the letter R as R. Don't pronounce it as R anymore. So it's, you know, you just imagine everyone's reaction when you make a drastic change like this. But that's how we should be, you know, be consistent, be logical, and be efficient in our approaches to different things. And, you know, such is the case for the English alphabet. The letter S. We don't need the letter C to represent the letter S, as in circle. The letter S is just fine, but we need to drop the E in front. It's the letter S. That's what it is. Sit. We're not saying S-sit. We're saying sit. So when we teach what that curved symbol is, it should be S. And I don't think S makes a different sound. It might make a Z sound in some words, I feel like. But I don't have like every S example. But for the most part, S is fine. But we definitely don't need two S's in a word like grass. Just one is needed. Moving on to the letter T. For the most part, this letter is just fine. We just need to drop the way that we teach how to pronounce it. It's the letter T. It's not the letter T. You're adding an E. You're adding a separate sound to that. So it should be T. T is a word, and it is. T off in golf, T-E-E, or the golf tee, or the drink, T-E-A, T. And again, that doesn't make sense. You have you have two words where with different symbols in each, T-E-E and T-E-A, but they both make the T sound, so that really shouldn't be a thing. They need to make different sounds. Yeah, every symbol has its own sound. That's what we're trying to achieve here. So when you look at a word, you know how to pronounce it. We don't need to look at T-E-E and T-E-A and say, how do I pronounce those? They're spelled differently, but they sound the same. Again, that's like putting square, circle, triangle, and square, circle, circle, but saying that's both square, circle, triangle in both instances. No, it's not. Okay, we have different letters, so we should have different sounds. T-E-A should sound differently than T-E-E. Next, we have the letter U. And again, listen to that sound. U. That should be a word, U, because we're making the Y sound and the U sound, which is also represented by two O's. But in this case, we're saying the letter U is the letter, but you have to know how to say Y in order to pronounce the letter U. But that's two words, and but that's a word, U, and it is. It's Y-E-W is U. So the letter U should probably be oo or just because when you see the letter U in the word run, R-U-N, you're making the sound. So it shouldn't be the letter U. It should probably be the letter I mean, that's the sound that it makes in, you know, the majority of words that it's in. Run, jump, instrument, etc. I think, you have the word glue, G-L-U-E. And there's no need to have U-E. Those are two different sounds, E and It's not glue. It's glue. So again, those combinations of those two symbols making one sound, that needs to go. U-E, like I mentioned in the beginning of the video. U-E, two different sounds. So if you want glue, it should be G-L and then a third symbol to represent the U sound if it's not going to be O. All right, so, being logical, being consistent, that's what needs to happen here from my perspective. So the letter U, we should be teaching that. That's the letter as in run, as in fun, instrument. I mean, so many different sounds. I'm not sure if it has another sound like ooh. In some cases, I know on its own. It does in the word constitution or any other word that has tution in it. It should be constitution. If the symbol U in run, fun, and jump makes the sound, then to be consistent, when you see the word constitution or institution, it should be constitution, institution, the Constitution of the United States. No, but we're saying constitution. All of a sudden, you, the of run and gun and fun, becomes ooh in the between T-U-T-I-O-N. So instead of saying tushin, we're saying tushin. Now it doesn't make any sense. And then you have the combination T-I-O-N. It's not T-I-O-N, it's shun. How does that make sense? How is T-I becoming sh in that instance? That's just more logical fallacy. All right, moving on. Five letters left. V. No problem here. Live. Viral. I can't think of any other V words off the top of my head. Love. So instead of saying that's the letter V, again, drop the E and just teach it. That's the letter V. That's the sound that you make with it. That's that. Moving on to the letter W. I mean, listen to that. Double U. I mean, that's like a word. That's like four sounds. That's double U. That's five sounds you're making to teach or to say that symbol, the shape with the two, two lines at the end and the one line in the middle. The upside down M, W. No, that's a word. W should actually be a word. I mean, something that makes five sounds, W. That really should be a word. So no, we should be teaching the letter W is W, as in one, as in W, window, as in W, utter. So that's the letter W, not the letter W. What is that? Oh, man. Okay, the letter X, I don't know, it's another one of these, it's like W. X, you're saying three sounds. X should probably be its own word, and maybe it is, E-K-S or something, I don't know. But I don't even know if the letter X should be in the, you know, Y. Why is a letter X in there? Look at the word xylophone. You're pronouncing X like a Z. How is that? That's like saying a square is always a square, but when you put a square next to a circle, square becomes a triangle. No. The letter X, if it's going to ever be pronounced as X, which it shouldn't be, that shouldn't even be a thing. We have E, we have a symbol for that, K. K makes the K sound, and S is the S sound. So X, that should be a word. But no, we have a letter X. No, that doesn't make sense. All right, we have xylophone, we have, I don't know, what other, we have ox. Like the animal, the ox, O-X, well, that should be O-K-S, ox. Unless you're, have it, you know, if O is going to be O, then A of ox, O-X, the A should be a separate word. So I forgot about that. O makes the O sound. It makes the U sound as in food. It makes the U sound as in good. Good. It makes the U sound as in one, W-O-N. And it makes the A sound as in ox. So there's O making four or five different sounds, like the letter A. Doesn't make sense. Last two letters, the letter Y. Well, we already have, so again, we're saying W of W plus I, Y. That's two sounds together to make this letter Y. Do we need, it should be the letter Y of the word you, Y-O-U, Y. It's not Y-U, it's you. It's not Y-L-O, it's yellow, Y-E-L-L-O-W. I mean, there should not be two L's in there, and there probably shouldn't even be a W. Yellow should be Y-E-L-O, yellow. That's the four symbols that make the four sounds that you're saying. But we shouldn't be teaching that the word, the letter Y is Y, W, I. No, that's two different sounds. That should be a word, Y. And it is W-H-Y, but there shouldn't be an H in there. You're not saying W-H-I, because, you know, letter H, your teaching is H, but we never pronounce it like H, ever. So the word Y should just be W and the letter I, or whatever is going to make the I sound, Y, W-I, that's Y. But the letter Y should be Y, as in yellow, as in you, as in York, Y. That's the letter Y, not the letter Y. That's two different sounds, the letter Y. And lastly, the letter Z. Z, Z. Well, we shouldn't have the E at the end, just Z. It's the letter Z, as in zebra. As in Zoom, as in whatever other Z word is out there. There's no need to teach it as Z. No, it's the letter Z. Z. That's it. I don't think, I'm not sure if the letter Z takes on a different sound. I know sometimes the letter S might sound like a Z. I'm not sure if the letter Z ever sounds like an S. I mean, who knows? I don't know. But that's the problem. And that's the really end of this video. But I just, like I said, I wanted to point out a lot of these logical fallacies, a lot of these inconsistencies with how a letter makes a certain sound, but then when you put the same letter together, it makes a new sound. When you combine the letter, like, with another letter, like EA, it can make different sounds, like read and read. I read a book, R-E-A-D. I read a book, R-E-A-D. How is that consistent? That's not consistent. It's not logical. And so that's really all I wanted to come here and finally do this video. I think I've covered everything I ever meant to cover and go over when, you know, I've been wanting to do this for a couple years, a few years now. And so I think that's pretty much everything I've ever wanted to say and touch on and talk about in regards to the English alphabet. You know, I'm not the first one, I'm sure, to point this out. Definitely I'm not. And I'm sure other folks might have gone into either great into much greater detail, greater lengths to show the inconsistencies and in regards to the letters and the words and all that. So I don't really expect anything to change. I really doubt that all of a sudden, you know, starting next year or 10 years from now, all of a sudden we're going to create a new alphabet that represents and change all the words so that when you look at a word and you see the letters, you see the symbols, you see the shapes, you know how to pronounce it without having to pause and say, okay, I got to go to Google and type in this word and how to pronounce. And no, everything should be simple, straightforward. Look at it. Look at these symbols. Look at these shapes. That's how you pronounce them. And that's it. No funky combinations, no confusion and all that. So I don't think, probably not going to happen anytime soon, but I wanted to do this and, you know, maybe, you know, you agree with me a little bit. Maybe it's something you've thought about as well. Maybe you're younger. You know, I don't think I've ever thought about this when I was a kid. I mean, I'm sure I did. I can't remember what it's like to be 10 years old or 8 years old and, you know, looking at these letters and words and scratching my head and saying, why am I saying this? Why am I saying the letter this way in one word and then saying it differently in another word, right? So, yeah, that's the English alphabet for you. I don't know, I have no experience with any other alphabet. You know, I hear that English is difficult, probably because of everything I pointed out. The inconsistencies with the sounds that the letters make and the different combinations of the letters making different sounds. And yeah, it's confusing. It's just not consistent, you know, and it's illogical in a lot of ways. But yeah, I don't know what, you know, Japanese is like or Chinese. I mean, I'm sure every alphabet, every language has its flaws. But just because, you know, just because we have the alphabet and it's been this way for hundreds of years, doesn't mean it should remain this way. We need to be, you know, I like to think that a lot of us are progressive minded. I know a lot of us are not, a lot of people out there. I don't know if it's the majority or the minority, but there are people out there who do not refuse to change. Sometimes only change comes about, I don't want to get political, but sometimes change only comes about when it benefits a certain group or something like that, or when money is involved or whatever. But forget about all that politics or money, but it really, you know, my perspective that the English alphabet needs to change. And but I'm sure it's not anytime soon. I'm sure it'll be like another millennia until, and maybe we'll have maybe we'll have another symbol to represent the sound instead of the ooh of the letter O, but who knows. All right, so yeah, I think I covered everything I wanted to, and that's going to do it. So thanks for tuning in, and have fun pronouncing and trying to figure out how to say certain words and enjoy the absurdity that is the English alphabet and English language, or whatever language you might speak in addition. And yeah, that's going to do it. So I wish you all my best, and take care, and so long for now.